Hello, I am Peace Awesome Williamson, Director of Research Data Services at the University of Texas at Arlington Libraries. This instructional video covers the basics of the tidy data concept and principles, along with a few examples. The learning objectives are for viewers to be able to define commonly used terminology around tidy data, understand the structure of a data table, identify long and wide data structures, process wide and visual tables for use in programs that work with only tidy data. As an additional bonus, participants will also learn about R packages for tidying data and common R commands. Okay, let's get started with common terms. So, as someone interested in getting started with data, your goal may be to create fascinating visuals, run interesting analyses, or otherwise work with data in programs outside of the original program where the data were collected. Perhaps you have found or collected data and you cannot wait to get to the final product. What's important to get you there is structuring your data in a way that the new program will be able to read it. If you've collected data, accessed data online, received data from someone, or otherwise produced data, the next step is to perform quality checks of the data and restructure it for analysis. That is where tidy data comes in, because tools for analysis or visualization often only accept or prefer tidy data structure. So what is tidy data, and how does it differ from other common data terms? Now, there are terms you may be familiar with, such as file format and file structure. File format relates to how the data are organized, and data structure is the representation or layout of data. For file format, think about file types like Excel files, CSV, JSON, and SAS files. They are important for interoperability with programs, compactness, and other reasons. Meanwhile, file structure relates to how information is translated for a particular file type. In the case of tidy data, we are focused mainly on table or table-like structures. For table structures, there are certain terms that are of importance to know. First, there is the variable, which, in the case of tidy data, exists in its own column. The variable is the characteristic of interest that can be measured, counted, or tracked. Next is the observation or record, which is represented by a row. The observation has synonymous terms that may be used depending on your discipline. For an observation, there are a set of measurements collected for an element. An element can be a particular variable, such as each person in a study, each place of observation, each unique particle, or some other element. The values are each point of data represented in their own cell. For the data overall, there are data tables themselves, which are sheets, files, data frames, etc. The layout is dependent upon purpose, and this is where tidy data structure comes in. Lastly, there are processes that you can take to get from one structure to another. When programming, these are called functions, and they move from a set of inputs to possible outputs. Now that we are familiar with the terminology, let's look at the tidy data structure. For tidy data structure, the rules are as follows. 1. Each variable forms a column. 2. Each observation forms a row. And 3. Each type of observational unit forms a table. Variables that are part of the design, participant number, experimental condition, county ID, etc., or that may be key categorical moderators, should typically be placed first to the left and measured variables thereafter. Values fall in the cells under the variable being measured on the related observational row. Now let's discuss how to identify common issues with data structures in order to see what changes need to be made. The challenge is that these aren't always easy to spot. Leo Tolstoy stated, "Happy families are all alike. Every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. And this was interpreted by Hadley Wickham, the creator of tidy data, who stated, "Tidy datasets are all alike, but every messy dataset is messy in its own way." But we will look at the difference between messy and tidy data, and then we will touch on the five most common issues. First, we will start with an example of what I call a visual table. This is a table meant for human viewing. It's easy for a human to read and process what is there, but hard or impossible for a computer. That is because there are multiple data classes and species mixed in the same column and blank rows that space out the information. For a computer, blanks mean missing data. Now let's look at how the same data are displayed using tidy data structure. Each variable, animal, number of feet, and class, are represented with their values in columns below the header. Next, there are no blank spaces added for visual purposes, and each observation about the animals are given as a row. This setup is harder for us to read in a cumulative way, but the structure is easier for computer processing. So how to relate these into the five most common problems with how data are structured? The top five issues are as follows. 1. Column headers are values, not variable names. 2. Multiple variables are stored in one column. 3. Variables are stored in both rows and columns. 4. Multiple types of observational units are stored in the same table. And 5. A single observational unit is stored in multiple tables. Let's talk through each. We will mostly use one example to show its issues. To explore these common issues, we will take a look at this dataset that was downloaded from the Healthy People 2020 website, which is the former website for reporting health goals for the United States. This is reporting the annual rate of infant deaths per 1,000 live births related to all birth defects in 2015 through 2017. The data came from a linked birth and infant death dataset and include rates by the sex of the child, and race, ethnicity, age group, country of birth, and marital status of the mother. But for the sake of viewing, we will only look at the first 4 to 6 rows of each table. So what was issue one again? Column headers are values, not variable names. You can see on this table, rather than providing a column of years, the years are listed across the header. This is a common issue when data are displayed for viewing rather than for analysis. It's common to lay things out in this way, with a particular variable going across columns, in order to compare values within that variable. In this case, that is year. Looking at the tidy data example, you can see that now year has its own column, and the other variable's values, like race and sex, are repeated in order to record the data in this way. For issue 2, there are multiple variables stored in one column. This is often set up this way for people to be able to compare a value across different variables visibly. So you may see research findings and summary tables set up this way to make it easier for the human eye to understand and compare across groups. In this case, comparing a rate across demographic characteristics is done by placing variables like sex and race together in the same column. When we look at the tidy data version again, we can see that sex and race now have their own columns, rather than being placed together in the first column. Going along with the tidy data structure, all variables are listed across the top row, called the header row. Now let's look at issue 3. You'll notice that issue 1, when years go across the top header row, causes issue 3. In this case, rather than there being a column for rate, the rates are split across several columns. It would make it difficult to look at the data outside of the year variable because these numbers are tied to these years. This format is often referred to as wide data, where tidy data is referred to as long data. Wide data structure is usually most beneficial for data entry. So if you were to think about this as your own data set that you update each year, it would be quite easy to add a new column each year and input the new data. Again, we see that once year gets its own column, that also fixes the issue with rate existing in several columns. We can now name and analyze our data in our rate column. To add to this table, you could have new variables such as percentage, total, and other numbers that are not the same as the rate and can therefore exist in their own columns. Moving on to issue 4, this involves redundancy, often at the sacrifice of file size and efficiency. As you begin to work with large data sets, it is crucial to only include details that are necessary in data sets, as data can be joined or combined together to enrich what is there. Looking at this example, you can see that information that describes a variable have been included in the table. In this case, the variable being described is the race variable. Instead of a separate table that defines and provides additional details about each race, the details such as population and description are included along with a dataset of collected variables. So let's look at a live version of what is recommended. Here in Tableau, a data visualization software, I have data about COVID-19 testing from 2020. The dataset includes the number of positive, negative, and pending tests, as well as the total tests for each state, along with the number of people hospitalized and people who have died. However, you'll notice that the states are represented by their postal code abbreviations. Everyone is not familiar with postal code abbreviations. For example, ME for Maine, IA for Iowa, and GU for Guam may not be clear for everyone. Therefore, it is useful to add information about these states' full names. As you can see, I procured a data set of state and territory names matched with their postal codes. Rather than integrating these information into your data set for each observation, these two tables can be joined. If I create a new connection and select my table of states names with their abbreviations, I can specify which column from the first data set, in this case, state, matches with the column in the second data set, in this case, postal code. And now that information is appended for the purpose of visualization without having to alter my original data set. In addition, for the DFW COVID-19 dashboard that we managed last year, we also showed rates by country, which meant we also needed to identify which country these states fell in. Obviously, in this demonstration, they all exist in the United States. However, if we were to add data about places outside of the US, we clearly have a column now that distinguishes which data are from the United States that will allow it to be compared with other data. Okay, we have made it to the last issue, and that is when a single variable is stored in multiple tables. So if you recall, we described how wide data is useful for repeated data entry. Well, so is the act of duplicating tables. So let's imagine a data set is released every year by the World Health Organization that shows countries' GDP, populations, poverty levels, average education, and other details. How would you compare these across years if each year has its own data set to be downloaded? This is the issue we're describing with issue 5. It is commonly solved by an action of what I call marking and then stacking data. So for your first data set, you would add a column called year and copy the exact same year down the column. You would repeat this for each data set, filling in the year that is represented by that data. That is the marking. Now the stacking comes into play when you copy each data set and stack them one on top of each other so that now the data across years are marked and stacked together. So what are common tools and software that can be used to more quickly do this work? One tool specifically made for data restructuring and cleaning is OpenRefine. This is open source software, once called Google Refine, that makes these tasks into easy accomplishments. In addition, the software you already use may also perform these transformations. For example, I make frequent use of Tableau for visualizations, and it can pivot data. Lastly, programming languages are made for these types of tasks and more. A few quick lines of code will have your data completely transformed. In R, packages that you may want to explore include tidyverse, which is a package of packages, and tibble. Included in tidyverse are packages such as tidyr, dplyr, and mgridr, which assist with these steps. These packages include functions like gather, which transforms wide data into long, and two functions that are equivalent of our quote-unquote mark and stack. These are mutate, which allows you to add or modify variables, and bind, which allows you to stack data together, making more observations. The join function is similar to our Tableau example, where we combine data sets together to make a larger data set with more variables. So now that you're on the path to tidy data, where will you start? Thanks for viewing.